Welcome to week five. It is 1st of April, 2021 for the course of psychology, general psychology, Psy 1010. In this session, we will talk about one of the first and crucial subjects in psychology, which is called developmental psychology, one of my favorite courses in psychology. What does it mean, developmental psychology? Not in the words, in the concept. How do you think about the concept of developmental psychology? What is the keyword of development? All aspects of psychology has a keyword. At first, do you remember what was the meaning of psychology? What was the definition of psychology? What is psychology? Do you remember the first session or not? Matthew or Hamy? What is psychology? How can you define psychology? Psychology is the scientific studying of behaviors and mental processes. It is the well-defined definition of psychology. Psychology is the scientific studying or scientific investigation of behaviors and mental processes. With many aspects, with many branches, with many subcategorization. For example, when you say clinical psychology, what is the keyword of clinical psychology? Mental disorders. So clinical psychology is the scientific study of pathological behaviors and mental processes. Clinical, it is pathological. Pathological, it is something related to the illnesses, mental disorders. When you say social psychology, it is scientific study of social behavior and mental processes. This is social psychology. You can enter the keywords of each branch of psychology to the basic and crucial definition of psychology. Psychology is the scientific study of behaviors and mental processes. So each branch has a focal point, has a point of emphasis. For example, in social psychology, the keyword is about society. In clinical psychology, it is social. The keyword is about mental disorders. In personality psychology, the keyword about the constant and persistent features. Or here in developmental psychology, the keyword is change. When you say developmental psychology, what is developmental psychology? It is meant. Developmental psychology is the scientific study of changes in behaviors and mental processes, lifespan, through the lifespan, from the beginning minutes of the shaping and combination of sperm and ovules, and finally to the zygote, to the end of your life. We have developmental psychology just before death and sometimes after death. It is developmental psychology, yes. It is one of the best branches of psychology. It gives you a total perspective about the life during the lifespan. One of the most beautiful words in developmental psychology is seasons of life. We have two books in this concept by author. I think the author is Levinson. Levinson was the first scientist who explored the seasons of life in women and in men, separate seasons of life. Now you are in the season of young adulthood. I am in the season of middle age. After, for example, 15 years, I will enter to the old age season, or adolescence, or childhood, or adulthood, different seasons, with different quality of life, with different desires, with different needs, with different perspectives. This is called developmental psychology, not about the always positive changes, about the changes. So we have developmental psychology for older people, yes. For old age, yes. Changes in after 65 is called developmental psychology for older people. Do we have any developmental psychology for adolescents? Absolutely. one of the greatest periods of time in human life is adolescence, between 12, near 18 or 19. It is adolescence. Because of that, one chapter in all books sorry, I am at the class. Can I call you back after 2 hours?
Sure.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye, sir. Okay. Sorry. And one of the greatest chapters in developmental psychology always is about the, or in general psychology, is about the developmental psychology, as you see in your book. So highly recommended to book a complete book about developmental psychology. It's very useful for your personal life, very useful. As mother, as father, as a human being, you will have a deep understanding of yourself, a deep understanding. Okay, so let's get started this very sweet chapter. I love it. Nature, nurture, and prenatal development. Prenatal is this before laboring, before entering to the world. The learning outcomes are compared and contrast the influence of nature versus nurture. The basic question is, are we influenced by our nature, by our genetics, by our inheritance, by our instincts, or not? We are under influences of our environment, our nurturing, our training by parents, by society. Or no, it's an interaction between nature and nurture. There's no versus, there's an interaction. And describe developmental research techniques and discuss prenatal development. Nature versus nurture issue. We have two philosophical mind here. I don't know if it's in your book or not, but two philosophical mind here about the influence of nature and nurture in our life. At philosophical, from philosophers, not from scientists, about 300 to 200 years ago. One of them, both of them are, yes, I think both of them are French. One of them is Jean-Jacques Rousseau. And the second one is, sorry, British from England, it's John Locke. Jean-Jacques Rousseau, one of the greatest philosophers about the human nature, has a very fantastic phrase. He says, we are like a noble savage that we have a savage nature. We want to grow in the nature like other mammals. And we are noble savage. That noble part is specific for our humanity. So I think in the book with the title of Emil by Jean-Jacques Rousseau says that you should train, you should nurture your children so naturally without any conditional social conditions. Even sometimes he said that you should, for example, in winter, children should go out to the snow and without any specific dress, without any specific covering, it is nature. Okay, all humans, all mammals will grow in snow and spring and other seasons, very naturally. So basic thinking about the growing in nature is from Jean-Jacques Rousseau. On the other parts, John Locke says, as the word of tabula rasa. Tabula rasa is white disc, white paper. He says that when we enter this world, our soul, our mind, our spirit sometimes is like a white board with no spot on it, nothing. It is white on white on white. And society starts to have some points, some spots on the whiteboards. And after some years, we are not the same whiteboard. We are a blackboard. So basically we are tabula rasa. These are the basic concepts of nature and nurture. But after ending the 19th century and starting the psychology as a scientific branch, of academy as a science with the experimental investigation and experimental studies by different psychologists. So we had three major questions. One of them was nature versus nurture, which is more important. None of them is absolute, completely dominant. None of them. Just relatively dominant. Some parts is related to nature, some part is related to nurture. But nature versus nurture issue, the issue of the degree to which environment, nurture, and heredity, nature influence behavior. So we can have a good discussion by your own will. How do you think about it, Amy? Is it important nature or nurture? What's your own thinking about it? Our behaviors, our mental processes are influenced by our nature or nurture, or you think it is combination, which is dominant, and in which area, in which field, in which categorization of our life, we can see, for example, the influence of nature more than nurture, and other parts we can see the influence of nurture more than nature. How do you think about it, Amy?
You mean like the difference?
Difference, how do you think? Do you think that we are under the control of our nature completely? No, we are under control of nature and training by parents and society and peer group and school and other parts. Or no, it is a combination with between nature and nurture. How do you think?
Nature is the I think there is the difference. Like difference between like nature and nurture. But to me, I think
which is more important in your mind, nature or nurture? Environment or heredity or genetics or body?
I think it's maybe the environment is like important. Because like we live in the world. Like people live in the world, and we have like lots of like different types of like animals. But I have like it's like we need to like take care of the environment.
We should take care of environment, or no? We are under influence of environment. We are talking about development of human being, not about the interaction between human being and environment. Do you think our environment, parents are from our environment, our society, our environment, our natural environment is our environment, our peer group environment, even colleagues and, for example, co-workers in the organization's environment. Do you think in the process of mental processes and in the development of mental processes and behavior, which is more influential factor? Our environment have a great influence of shaping our behavior and mindset and feelings and, for example, ambitions about the future, hope about the future, or regression about the past, or mindfulness about the present time, all the features we are experiencing every day. Which factor is more influential in your mind? Nature, our environment, or not? Nurture, it is very genetic and based on your genetic, for example, that you have received from your parents. Matthew, how do you think? Let's Amy think about it more.
Yes, I need to.
I think nature is the more important one, in my opinion.
How many percent of your personal traits can you find common with your, for example, dad? How many percent? 20%, 10%, not at
like age, like a percent.
You haven't experienced your father at this age. When your father, as well, you were at the best scenario, you were a child. But how many percent of your traits is common with your dad, with your uncle, with your mother, with your other people that have a genetic trace with you?
Well, if I were to compare with my dad, percentage wise, I'd say I give it probably a 70, because he's the one who got me into sports, like mm-hmm. soccer especially, because he played as a child and his dad also played, so he got him into it. Mm-hmm. So I guess, how do I say it? It like passed off. So that, I think that's an example that I would give.
And other, for example, social interaction, social interest, sexual behaviors, intelligence, judgment, sometimes, for example, smartness in business and other parts. Can you find a high degree, a high percentage with your family members, other family members? One of them is also your dad, your uncle, your mom, or other family, or no? You can find your own way and own mindset without any similarities with your parents or other important, significant others in your life?
So I think from my mom's side, I would describe myself as a hardworking person. And mm-hmm. I think I got that from my mom, because uh-huh. her parents also, they work very hard. So maybe that also passed off to me. And that's the same with my dad. Like, they're both hard workers, because when they grew up, they didn't come from a lot of money, so they had to work to earn it. So now that I've grown up in a good environment, like, I learned something new from them. So I think hardworking is another trait that I would give myself, that I gathered from them. Because as well as their parents.
Very false common belief about that children are more likely to their dad. It is a false. Yeah. Genetically, it is not important. It is 50-50. Mm. It's 50-50. But false.
Yeah, I've heard that.
Yeah. And especially in America, in South America, in my country, Iran, it is very popular that we want to find the features of children only in their dad trace and dad family from that side, not only, but it is scientifically, it is false. 50% of your genetic is from your mom's side, and 50% is from your dad's side. This is not important that it doesn't have any dominancy between the dad or mom. There are some dominancy between the genes. Okay, but it's not related to that. This gene is driven from your father or from your mother. And how do you think, Hemi? Have you found any new answer or not the same?
I'm still thinking.
Okay, let's go forward and find new approaches. No longer a question of nature versus nurture, because both factors interact to produce developmental patterns and outcome. The keyword is interact. Interaction between nature and nurture. And now we ask, how and what degree do nature and nurture produce their effect? How and what degree? Two questions. How they produce their effects, and in what degree did they produce their effects? Experimentally control genetic makeup of laboratory animals, then study environmental influences. In identical twins, it is very important. A large part of the studies about the interaction between nature and nurture is related to the studies based on the identical twins. This is very great and very important part of scientific studies. Identical twins are the twins that their genetic is just as the same to each other. No difference. They are one person with two bodies. One person. Genetically, they are one person. And many times, especially for poor people, for poor family, they have separated the twins, identical twins, and separate to different socioeconomical level of families. Different. For example, highly rich people and average people. And after 20 years, they have studied the identical twins, which have developed in different countries, in different socioeconomical level and different families. And surprisingly, they have found that some specific traits is not related to the nurture, to the environment. It is the same between two people, between two identical twins. This feature here, just the same feature in the other identical twins. And on the other side, in some features, no, we can find great differences between identical twins who have developed in different countries, in different families, in different parts. Okay, so note that identical twins are a great treasure for our scientific studies about the effect of nature, effect of nurture, and interaction. Identical twins who share 100% of their genetic makeup and non-twin siblings raised apart, similarity as adults have importance of heredity. Any adopted children? Adopted children is something else. I have, for example, my son as my genetic son, biological son. And I will adopt another, for example, African child with the same nurture, with the same educational level for my both sons. One of them is biological, one of them is not biologically adopted. So we have a great difference between the nature. They're separated, not even from their, for example, parents, not the mom, not the dad, different mom and dad and different mom and dad, but the nurture, the environment, the education, the training, the kindness, the socialization is at the same level. After that, scientists studies the differences, and in identical twins, we can find the effect of nature because they have, they have different parts of nature and different parts of nurture, but the same nature, they are identical twins. In identical twins, we can find the effect of nurture environment in the same base nature because they are identical. Vice versa, in adopted children, we can find the effect of nature and nurture and environment. Why? Because they have different nature, different genetic makeup with the same, with the single environment. So we can find the effect of genetic or heredity here. Similarities with biological children in same family show importance of environment. So if the for example, your exam, your other parts, somebody has asked you about how we can consider the effect of environment, nurture versus genetic heredity or nature. We say that with the same makeup, biological makeup, genetic makeup, we can find in identical twins, we can consider, we can study the effect of nurture and environment because they have the same basic, just the same biological and genetic makeup. Vice versa, in the adopted children, we have different nature with the same nurture. We can find the effect of nature in the environment, in the personality. And we have three parts of research, three types of research. It is very important in developmental psychology. Research method is very important because many of the results, many of the scientific findings that we can receive at the end of it, the research in developmental psychology is related to the time, especially in the long-term research. We should consider developmental, for example, 10 years. There's a very good, also a little old book about business psychology, which is called What Business School, What They Don't Teach You in the Harvard Business School, something like it. Let me show you. It's a very good research in what this book by Mark McCormack. Have you heard about it or have you read this book? It is not new. It is about, I think, 3 years, 30 years ago. But until now, it is very important book in the basis of business mindsets and business success, business mindsets. It is what they don't teach you at Harvard Business School. It is also about not the business. It is about the mindset of a successful business. It's a long-term research. Near, I think, 10 to 50 years, to 15 years. At the first years of the Harvard Business School, they have asked some question from the students about their future, their goal setting, their written goal setting. And after some years, they have gone to the same students and asked about their physical successes and business successes and mental health and other. This is a long term. I'm highly recommended to look at this book. It's a not new book, but very, very good book about your mindset for success. It is one of the 10 books that all the sites highly recommended to business students to read about the importance of mindset. So cross-sectional research comparing people of different ages at the same point in the time. For example, we want to know the effect of age on the business ambition. We choose 10 person at the age of 20, 10 person at the age of 30, 10 person at the age of 40, 10 person at the age of 50, and 10 person at the age of 60, at the same time, in the same time. And compare their, for example, business or success ambition about the future. And we can, after that, is study the effect of age on the degree of business or success ambition about the future. All longitudinal research is studying the same people as they age. As I talk about it, this longitudinal research is, for example, what has happened in Harvard in the book I talk about with you. And sequential research, a combination of cross-sectional and longitudinal. In longevity, in long term, it become a little shorter, not, for example, 10 years, for 2 years. And in that time, we use different people at the different age and consider different age group examined at several points in time. It is very regular, very popular, very common in the research method to use sequential research. Not short time, like cross-sectional, not so long-term, like longitudinal research. And parental development, it is the basic biological basics of genetics, chromosomes. What are the chromosomes? Structures that contain all basic hereditary information. 23 pairs, not 23 numbers, 23 pairs show it will be 46, amount of 46 chromosomes in 23 pairs. One chromosome of each pair from mother and one from father. The structure of chromosomes are genes. Genes are the basic in four dimension, in four types. We can find the genes that they can shape the chromosomes. Now, for example, in DNA and RNA, now they said that in Pfizer, we have produced the coronavirus vaccine based on the genes, not in the immunization, based on the genes. So now, some people, some scientists believe that the major science for this century, for the last century, was physics and chemistry, especially physics. For this century, many scientists believe that genetics is the science of 21st century. We will have many, many, many genetics interactions, genetics interventions in human being until the end of the 21st century. And zygote, the new cell form by the union of an egg and a sperm, egg from mother and a sperm from father. The combination is zygote. The first cell of every human being is zygote. The first cell in the body of your mother. The first cell, only one cell is zygote. After reproduction of zygote, I will be Arash, you will be Hemi or Matthew and other people. The first cell, cell is zygote, the new cell formed by the union of an egg from your mother and a sperm from your father. Okay, you can see here, it is conception entering the sperm and 23 pairs of chromosomes and DNA sequences. These are four types of genes and these are the genes. It is prenatal development. Prenatal development is the development before labor, when you are at the body of your mother. Again, we have two parts of living in the body of your mother. At first, you are embryo, and after that, you are fetus. A developed zygote that has a heart, a brain, and other organs is embryo. After 8 weeks until the birth, it is fetus. An age of viability is the point at which a fetus can survive if born prematurely, about 22 weeks. The natural period of pregnancy is near 40 weeks. The natural pregnancy, it is between 38 weeks to 42 weeks, with the average of 40 weeks, near 9 months. It is the natural period of pregnancy. Average of 40 weeks, between 38 weeks to 42 weeks. But after 22 weeks, year after, between 6 or 7 months, it is age of viability. It is premature, yes. Should go under the some tools in the hospital for 1 month, for 2 months, but it can be live. Before that, if it is any labor, any out of body of the mother, any labor, it will be dead. But after 22 weeks, it is premature. Yes, it is not mature. It should be considered and cared very carefully in the hospital. But the children, the baby, the newborn will be alive with a high rate of probability also after 22 weeks. But the average of labor is about 40 weeks with the 38 weeks to 42 weeks. It is a very important, very, very important phrase in developmental psychology. All stages of development, human development, has critical periods or sensitive periods. During prenatal development, time when the fetus is particularly susceptible to certain kinds of stimuli, especially in the first 3 months. The first 3 months is called organogenesis stage. Organogenesis is the time that your basic and foundation of your body is shaping. The first 3 months of pregnancy. It is very sensitive, very, very sensitive. Any harming to your mother body can deform your body for all of your life. Any very, very, very little changes in the body of your mother in the first 3 months of pregnancy. It is called sensitive period or critical period. Phenylketonuria, we are talking about the materials that can, some words and some phrases about the pregnancy. Phenylketonuria, it is cannot reproduce enzyme needed for normal development. Untreated causes intellectual disability. This is one of the PKU. PKU, it is one of the greatest illness during prenatal, during the pregnancy that can shape a very long-term and whole life problems in the next generation or in the future. Sickle cell anemia. Anemia is the problems in your blood. every all types of reduction and deficiency in your blood cells is called anemia. We have different parts of different types of anemia. One of them is sickle cell anemia, causes abnormally shaped red blood cells. It's a deficiency in your red blood, not the white blood. And Tay-Sachs disease, inability to break down fat, is another problem during the prenatal period or pregnancy. And the greatest and most famous and the most popular and most current problem during prenatal is Down syndrome. Extra chromosome at conception causes mental impairment. Extra chromosome, it is in the chromosome, the pair number 21. Sometimes it is called 21 syndrome or trisomy, 21 trisomy. Trisomy is meant to be three, because of two, we have pairs, 21, 22, 20. We have 23 pairs of chromosomes. If number 21, the pair number 21 becomes, instead of two chromosome, becomes three chromosome, it ends to mental disorder, something called Down syndrome. Also in the previous time, in the last centuries and before scientific period, people say that they have some problems with God and some religious problem for this. But now that we know that, yes, they have some specific abilities. Many of them work normally and adapt with the society. But there is a genetic problem in some abilities, not all abilities. There's a very, very good movie about this problem. Several movies, but I want to show you two movies if you like to see movies about Down syndrome. At first, it is
Grammarly is your personal writing assistant for clear emails, confident messages, stronger essays, and more to help you and your kids get work done from anywhere. Write with Grammarly, wherever you work.
Mexico. Can you see it?
Yes.
It's a movie so-called The 8 Day.
8 Days?
8 Day.
It's an American movie?
No, it is French movie, but has a good translation. It is one of the greatest movie I have ever seen. Greatest movie. It is fantastic.
It's
fantastic. Brilliant. And the actor is a real mental disorder, a real boy with mental disorder.
Ça m'étouffe. C'est pas moi à m'occuper de ça, c'est à vous. On paye des impôts pour ça.
Moi, j'avais un chauffeur. Moi, je n'ai pas le chauffeur.
J'ai dû le sortir de mon magasin. Votre sourire n'est pas sincère. Un bon vendeur a toujours un sourire sincère.
It is one movie, another movie about Down syndrome. This movie is American movie, so-called, about the father, that the father is with Down syndrome, not the children. This movie.
I like going fast on land too, because the faster I go, the younger I feel.
This movie. The title of movie is I Am Sam. I Am Sam.
Think about what it is.
This father has Down syndrome. But he's a father.
Constancy.
Perfect, perfect, perfect.
Patience and it's about listening, and it's about...
I think I saw the movie.
It's perfect.
Long time ago.
Perfect. Perfect. You cannot understand that the actor is not really a person with a Down syndrome. You think that, yes, because the actor of the 8th day is really a person with a boy with mental disorder. But in this movie, I forgot that this is Michelle Pfeiffer. This lady is Michelle Pfeiffer, but I forgot the name of the actor, which was the Madonna first spouse, was Sean Penn. Sean Penn is the actor of the movie with Michelle Pfeiffer. If you want to see the good movies about mental disorders, especially Down syndrome, these two movies are perfect. Also, there's another movie in my country in Farsi language. That film is fantastic. Not too bad to know about the mental disorders around yourself, because many people have some problems. And for example, yesterday was the World Day of Bipolar Disorder. The last day of March is the World Day, International Day of Bipolar Disorder. And many people around you have bipolar disorder, but you cannot find that what's their problem. Because of that, knowing about the problem is very good. Okay, let's go to the PowerPoints again here. Down syndrome extra chromosomes at conception causes mental impairment. And modern nutrition. We have three problems in modern nutrition and modern smoking and other parts. Teratogens are the materials or the food can create some problems in the fetus, in the prenatal period of your body when you are and your mother. In your body of your mother, the food, teratogens is especially used for foods, environmental agents for drugs, chemical, everything that produce a birth defect, and mother's illness. Some, for example, problems with mother, especially some illnesses in the lung for oxygen, and in brain sometimes. It is illness. It is not about the food. It is not about the drugs. It is not about the smoking. It is not about the alcohol. It is about the illnesses. Gastrointestinal indigestion problems or blood problems or sometimes cancer during the pregnancy and other problems. It is the second teratogens. And finally, it is drug, alcohol, and nicotine use. It is very important to alarm to the mothers in pregnancy that absolutely quit any type of drug, alcohol, or nicotine use, even at the lowest dosage. It is not important of dosage, especially at the first 3 months of pregnancy. It is very important. They cannot kill the babies, drug, alcohol, and nicotine, but they have a long-term effect on their lives. For example, nicotine will end to the lower weight, lower than 3 kilograms, a lower weight labor. Also drug, also alcohol. It's very interesting that I heard and I read one research about the fathers that using cocaine by men can change their sperm structure in long term. Using cocaine. If your father of a child is a cocaine abuser for long term, their sperm can change and become a genetic problem for their children. Cocaine is the only substance that has a severe impact on the sperms of men, not on the eggs of the women. Because of that, drug, alcohol, nicotine, all types of drugs. Cocaine is drug, marijuana is drug. Also, the nicotine is drug, but in another categorization, so-called substances. All types of drugs, amphetamines. Amphetamines are major killer cause of death in the pregnancy. Fetal alcohol syndrome, FAS, is a very, very high level and high degree, high dominance in people with fetal alcohol syndrome, and fetal alcohol effects, or FAE. It is about the mothers that use alcohol for long term. Okay. Now we enter the infancy and childhood after labor. Describe the major competencies of newborns. Explain the milestones of physical, social, and cognitive development during childhood. The extraordinary newborn reflexes sensory developments. All mammals at the first stages of their life have some motor memory. Motor memory is the memory about your movements. You have some movements when you are at the first time, at the first minutes, at the first days in the world as a newborn. Newborn is used for a person before 28 days. The first 28 days, the first 4 weeks of your life is called newborn. After that, you are not newborn, you are infant. The first 4 weeks is for newborn, newborn age. Only 28 days. In those 28 days, in those 4 weeks, all we have some motor memories, some movements that can provide us to protect us against our environment and to have the minimum connection for survive with our environment. The major reflexes are crying. We cry, but we have never learned to cry. It is reflexes, it is natural born, it is instinct. Watching, when we born, we know how to watch, but we never have learned how to watch. Grasping, we grasp everything at the first days of our life, but we haven't learned anything about the grasping. And finally, sucking. We suck the mammals for milk and other nutritions, but we haven't learned. These are the four major basic reflexes in all newborns: grasping, crying, watching, and sucking. Why these are important? Because by these parts, we can do many things for our survival. It's very important. Autonomic involuntary responses to incoming stimuli. It is reflexes. Neonate born with rooting, sucking, gag, startle, and Babinski reflex. Babinski reflexes is not for your survival. It is a reflexes at the end of your foot, when at this part, something like it. All children do it. They make the different parts of their foot again. It's called that, yes, nervous system is working good, is working in a good position, but it is not related to the survival. But gag is very important. If you have something wrong in your mouth, you should gag it. And you have never learned to gag something. It is motor memory, inherent motor memory. It is the memory for the movement that transferred to you by inheritance, not by your learning. And sensory development. At first part, we want to go for sensory development. Neonates can follow moving objects within their field of vision, show some depth perception, discriminate facial expression, recognize their mother's voices at 3 days old, and recognize different tastes and smells. It's very fantastic. Only after 3 days, you can recognize your mother voices. After 10 months, all children can recognize women from men after 10 months. And all healthy and all normal children, normal infants, can distinguish between all other women from their mothers. All normal infants. But until the age of two, after 24 months, they cannot distinguish their father from other men. Until the age of two, children cannot distinguish their father from other men. But at the age of 10 months, not only they can distinguish all women from all men, but also they can distinguish their mother from other women. So if the father died before the age of two, the child never will miss the father because he cannot distinguish father from other men. The new father, the new man, the new husband will be their father, yes. But it is not about mother. Why? Because of sense of smell and the voice. Newborn can recognize their mother by their sense of smell and voice, especially with the sense of smell. This is called sensory development and physical development. Triple birth weight in 1 year, height increased by 50%, especially trunk and legs, especially 50% in trunk and legs. And attachment, it is one of the, we are coming to the middle childhood after the age of two, after age of two, between one and two, especially after two. Attachment theory is one of the greatest and basic theories in developmental psychology that talks about the how is the attachment between the maternal objects, for example, persistent caregivers or grandma and other people. It is especially the caregiver. Caregiver can be your mother, usually it's your mother. Sometimes, for example, a permanent, for example, nurse or your grandma. Now, it is about the caregiver, not especially about your biological mother. The theory of attachment or attachment theory is very basic theory in describing the process of mental development and especially the sense of security in children. And after many years, I think it has published and established for 50 years, near the half of the century. But after half of the century, also, it is one of the most important and crucial theories in the whole life, in the development of whole life. Why? Because this model with copy and paste in other stages of your life, your attachment model will copy and paste in your other parts of your, in your marital state, in your organizational position, in your romantic love and other parts. Everything is related to your attachment theory. Because of that, positive emotional bond, not thought, not action. It is about positive emotional bond that develop between a child and a particular individual, usually a caregiver, particular individual, not everybody. Especially it is caregiver, and what types of caregivers? Sometimes it is ordinary your mother. So in attachment theory, we are talking about the bondage with your mother, with your caregiver. How do you feel this attachment? Is it secure? Is he or she is always available for your child? Is he or she giving the sense of security, the sense of trust, the sense of support to the child or no? The child think that I am in the world, free in the world, everything I want to do, I can do. It is not, I am not important for nobody, anybody. And after that, we go to the theories like, for example, transactional analysis or TA by Eric Byrne, which says that we have four states of interaction with people. First, I am not okay, you are not okay. The second, I am okay, you are not okay. The third, I am not okay, you are okay. And the final state is, I am okay, you are okay. This is the final state that we have two good books about. That first is I Am Okay, You Are Okay by Thomas Harris. Also, it is not a new book, but a very good book for analyzing the transactions between you and other people. It is called I Am Okay, You Are Okay by Thomas Harris, the book. The second book is Staying Okay by Thomas Harris and also by his wife. Those are the good books for studying about the how attachment and how, for example, transactional models involved with our daily life, with your father, with your mother, with your coworker, with your colleague, with your boyfriend, girlfriend, with everybody, even in the street. If you go to the street and you can use this model for analyzing the behaviors of different parts of personality are interacting and transacting together. Because of that, attachment theory is very important in psychology, especially in social psychology, especially in organizational psychology. It is very important for us about the job matching, to know about the attachment style of people. People will be successful or not based on their attachment. If you have an insecure attachment pattern, you will have a fear of success, not fear of failure. If you feel that the world is insecure, we cannot trust the world, you cannot be successful. You have a fear of success, which is called Jungian complex. Jungian complex coined by Abraham Maslow, the greatest thinker of positive psychology and humanistic psychology. Also, we use and we know about his hierarchical needs of Maslow in organizational theories and in management, also in leadership. Other phrase coined by Maslow is Jungian complex. Jungian complex is mean fear of success, not fear of failure. It's fantastic. Maslow says that many people have the fear of success. Why? Because they think if I will be successful, I will accept the responsibility and accountability for that success. It's a very hard situation for me for a long time. I should be responsible for the success. So, no, I don't want a high degree of success. It is Jungian complex that indicates the story of Prophet Jonah in the abdomen of the fish, and the story that you know about the Jewish story and also Christian story, and also in Islam, there are some stories about the Jonah. It is Jungian complex. So it is very important for you as the future generation of leaders and managers to know about the behavioral analysis theory of psychology, at least about the behavioral analysis. It is not important to know about the mind analysis, the thought analysis, the emotional analysis. Also, I think it is very important. But if you don't have enough time to pay attention to all aspects of psychological dimensions of your employees, of your coworkers, of your managers, at first you should pay attention to their behavior, and their behavior should be analyzed in the scientific method, in the scientific patterns, which comes from psychology. One of the greatest chapters, one of the greatest topics in analyzing is at first attachment theory. Second part is TA or transactional theory that I recommended the books, not new books, but good books about TA. Harlow researched with monkeys, and he was one of the first scientists in psychology who worked about the behavioral change and attachment in monkeys. It was very, very interesting experiments with monkeys that what is the degree of maternal instinct? Is there anything so-called maternal instinct? Do you think that there is an instinct in mammals, all mammals, for example, lions? Sometimes you see some movies, some videos in YouTube that shows that, for example, a tiger is a hunter of a cow, and the cow is pregnant, and during the hunting, cow had a labor, and after killing the mother, the tiger or the, for example, lion will keep the child and cuddle the child and hug the child as his or her mother. Is there something so-called maternal instinct? Do you believe it or not, Matthew? Do you think we have something in so-called maternal instinct of to be a mother in mammals or not?
Wait, what is it called? Maternal instinct?
Oh, yeah. Is there something like...
I don't think so.
What about you, Amy? Do you think we have maternal instinct? An instinct only for mothers or not?
Only mother?
Yeah. Is there an instinct for all mammals? for lions, for tigers, for parrots, and for example, cows, for sheep, also for humans, for homos, like monkeys, like chimpanzees, like homo sciences, like human beings. Is there any instinct for to be a mother or not? It is, we learn to be how a mother, to be another self, a father, about mother. How do you think?
Maybe yes.
Yes.
Maybe.
Yes or no? Maybe is a very average answer. In which aspects of your life do you think that we have maternal instinct? In which aspect? For example, in feeding, bottle feeding, or for example, milking to the children or not? Is that instinct or not? Or for hugging the children or caring about the children? Because based on this instinct, some people say that if female, all female in the animals and human beings has a maternal instinct, and what is the icon of maternal instinct? The icon of maternal instinct is caregiving, to be a caregiver, care about other people's. And for example, because of that, many people think that we have a job orientation, job direction to specific jobs like nursing. So many people think that, for example, some jobs like nursing is very good for women. Why? Because they have maternal instinct. What is the relationship between maternal instinct and job and jobs like nursing? It is about the ability to care, to be careful about other people's. Women can be more careful about other people's because they are women. They have the instinct of to be a mother. And as the same, they can use this instinct in their job as a nurse. I don't know, it is true or false. Also, statistics says that yes, it is true, because 95% of educated registered nurses all around the world are women. Registered nurse going to academy. When I entered the nursing, my license, my bachelor degree is in nursing. When I entered the nursing, the ratio between us as men, as male, and female, one to 18. One man, 18 girl in the field, in the major field of nursing as an academic field. One to 18. One boy, a student, 18 female student, girls. Also in America, statistics shows that 95% of nurses are female or women. One of the interpretation for this rate of high rate of nursing in female is about the maternal instinct. Do you think these interpretations are correct? If it is correct, perfect. If it is not correct, what is your crisis about this interpretation? How do you think about critical, what is your critical thinking about this interpretation? Matthew, at first you.
I think that statement was correct. I don't think there's anything wrong with it.
It's correct that caregiving is an instinct in women. Instinct, not necessary to learn it. When you say instinct,
instinct,
but it is not learned by anybody. You know it before you enter the world. Think about it during the break. Now we have 15 minutes break. Think about it.
Okay.
That is to be careful about other people's as a woman is an instinct or not, because of the social observation, observational learning, female, not inherently, by the generation, by their mother, by their grandma and other women around them, they know that yes, we can do it better than men. After 15 minutes, I will visit you again. Hello again. Hello again. I'm here. And it starts with the PowerPoint. One of my friends called me just now and say he has seen a good movie, 2020, good movie. He was very passionate about this movie. Let's show you, not too bad to see it. The name of the movie is Father. The name of this, the father.
Date of birth?
The 1st of December, 1937.
You're living with your daughter at the moment?
Yes, until she goes to live in Paris.
Why do you keep going on about Paris?
You told me.
No, I didn't.
The movie is Father.
The other day. You've forgotten? She's forgotten. Paris. The English there.
About a man with the Alzheimer problem.
I say you're gorgeous.
Thank you. I must say he's charming.
Yeah, not always. Laura has come round to help you.
I don't need her or anyone else. I can manage very well on my own.
What is the best movie you have seen about the business, except that Wolf of the Wall Street? Have you seen any other movie about business?
I saw lots of movies.
About the business? About business, not about, I have seen also many movies. Highly recommended to see this movie. This movie is about business. Investigators, defenders, and let me show you. There's a movie about the American recession in 2008. This movie is very good, and it is about business.
Dale, these are extraordinary times, as you very well must know.
This movie.
I don't understand.
It is Marginal Call. Go today. The movie is Marginal Call, 2011. It's about business. Very good movie about business.
I was working on something, but they wouldn't let me finish it. So take a look at it.
About 2008 recession of economy in America. Perfect. Very. You should see some movies, some cinema movies about business. It helps you to understand not the real world, but to have a good passion and sometimes some resilience,
yeah, hello. I need you guys
some fighting in business. If you want to be a businessman or woman.
Wait a minute, what am I looking at?
It's Marginal Call.
Whoa, is that?
It gets ugly in the horror.
Is that figure right?
Looks pretty right to me.
Amy, have you seen any movie about business except The Wolf of Wall Street or not?
I think I saw the business movie.
Uh-huh.
But I cannot remember. I saw many. Oh, I know. I know one of them.
This Wall Street?
No, not that movie.
Glengarry Glen
Ross. I think I saw the Godfather.
Oh, Godfather also is not about the business. Apartment, is this about business? It is not a business movie. It is the not about the business, about the business of cinema. So let's go to our PowerPoint, and highly recommended to Google to read the extra books in addition to your academic books about business, about management, and also movies in your extra time when you have it, you don't have any patience for studying, you are tired, you want to see something or to connect it to your major field, to your business. For example, for myself, it is connected to psychology. Everybody around me just now before the, during the break, my friend called from Virginia that last night I have a good movie about psychology, for example, that I introduced you, The Father 2020. after sometimes you have a good package of the films and movies, not directly related to your job, but indirectly related to the concept of popular job, especially books and movies. So we want to talk about the physical development. Childcare outside the home can be beneficial, especially for children from disadvantaged homes, if it is a high quality program, especially after schools. We have two types of out of the home programs for children that can be beneficial for children. After school, it is ordinary, but especially in the single parent families, it's very good for children to have after school activities. Why? Because it helps their very slow socialization process a little rapider and rapider and rapider, speedy. Why? Because they are connecting with other people except of regular peer group, regular teacher, regular mother, regular father, especially in single parent families. Other parts for out of the home activities for children, which is very good for them, is about classes, for example, mathematics class or physics class, chemistry class, biological class, in extra time. It helps them to create something in their mind, in addition to the knowledge they are receiving, to create something in their mind as the future idea, as the idea for the future jobs, or activities, or social activities. It's very good during the higher school, especially in middle school. It is very important. Middle school is a good time for education. You are not so rapid and in the hormonal stress like high school, and you are not so immature like children. Between the age of 12 to 15 is a very good time for learning these topics. We have four parenting style. Parenting style is the fundamental of your parenting style. The style of your parents is the fundamental of your parenting style for next generation, for your children. We have four parenting styles. One, authoritarian parenting style. Two, permissive parenting style. Three, authoritative parenting style. And four, uninvolved parenting style. Authoritarian parenting style, it is rigid, punitive, demand obedience, require a lot from the children. It is something like army. It's not a home, it's an army. It's a navy. It's not a home. It's very rigid, only obedience and hyper demanding. Honestly, it is the easiest way of parenting. Easiest way. Why? I am your parent. I am your responsible. I am your boss. I am your God. And you cannot do anything without my permission, not without my legal permission, without my mind permission, thought permission, heart permission, money permission, and other things. Many people choose this type of parenting. Why? It is very easy. You are not training your child. You are not nurturing your child. You are growing your child only at the physical size. And your child, at the best scenario, will be a very obedient people in the future, very obedient. No creativity, no risk study, no passion, nothing. Something like his or her father or mother, very rigid, punitive, and at the best scenario. At the mid scenario, not worst scenario, he or she will become a mental with mental disorder, like anxiety disorder, like depression, like aggression. All are the symptoms and signs of mental disorders. And the worst scenario, he or she will be a rebel, be antisocial. He want to damage everything because of his or her silent anger of his or her parent. So sorry, the most popular, the most usual parenting style is the one of the worst, only one of these four is worse than this parenting style. Only the number four is worse than number one. And number four is not so popular, it's not so usual. The second style is permissive, relax or in consistent direction require little from their children. Happy father, happy mother. They are good, happy mother and father, but they are not a good coach. They are not a good trainer. Everything you want to do, okay, we are with you. It is a liberal family, it's a democratic family, it's a false belief also. It's permissive. Something a little better than passive, a little better. The third part, the best part, is authoritative. Firm, set limits, use reasoning, explain things, encourage independency. It's the best parenting style. Firm, set limits. It is not unlimited like permissive. It is not always limited like authoritarian. Set limits and motivate children to be independent. Why? Because you should be the next generation. And the last part, last style, is uninvolved. It's no little interest, emotionally detached. It is okay, it's the family and everybody has a room and goes to his or her room and I go to my room and everybody is at his work. No attachment, no talking to each other very deeply, very seriously, nothing. Parenting style influenced by child's temperament. It is very important. It is not only about the parenting and about the parents. Sometimes and in some degree, the parenting style is a reaction to the natural features, natural modern born features of the baby, of the children. It is called temperament. Temperament is something that you have, some characters. This is the base of character. After character, it is the base of personality. We have three parts. At first is temperament, second one is character, the third one, the final state, is personality. The basic natural born, mother born traits that you have with yourself, it is called temperament. To some degree, the parenting style is a reaction to temperament. It's a reaction to temperament. Erik Erikson, one of the greater theorists about the child development, life development, not only about the childhood, with eight parts. It is the first one who talked about the lifespan development. Freud, for example, talked about the development at the fourth stage, with the end stage finish at the age of 16, not 60. Or Piaget talked about something like it about 15 or 16 or 17. At the middle of teenage, the development will be fixed and will not change. Also based on their theory, not new theories. One of the first theories that talk about the development in lifespan from the birth to the death was Erik Erikson. He has some crucial words, crucial phrase in psychology. At first it was identity crisis. The phrase identity crisis is from Erik Erikson because he never knew who is his father. And in all his life, he was looking for his father. And he felt that the major part of my problem is about the identity. So he called it identity crisis. And after that, Levinson talked about the adolescence crisis, which is equal to the question in adolescence crisis is, who am I? It is a question about identity. So identity crisis is from Erikson. And Erikson talked about eight stages and contrast. For example, the first stage is trust versus mistrust. In the first year, the problem and the conflict for a child at the first year of the age is trust versus mistrust. Can I trust to my environment, to my caregiver? Also, it's not about at the level of thinking, it's that level of body, because there's no thinking style, there's no mental syntax, there's no mindset in the, when you are at the age of one. But at the body side, he or she thinks that, can I trust my mother, my caregiver, my environment? Or no, I cannot trust. For example, the first comparison in the Erikson developmental stages, it is called psychosocial development. Yes, the name of the title of the theory of Erik Erikson is psychosocial. Because of this, I said Erik Erikson because we have two Erikson in psychology. One, Erik Erikson is a theorist of developmental psychology, and second one is Milton Erickson. Milton Erickson is a psychiatrist and the founder of modern hypnotherapy, very, very famous man. He lived in Phoenix in Arizona, and he died some years ago, also Erik Erikson. We have two major Erickson in psychology. Erickson's theory of psychosocial development says change in our interaction and understanding of each other and our knowledge and understanding of ourselves as members of society. Because you don't live in a cave, you have some major interaction with your society. Your mother is from your society. Your father is from your society. One member of everybody around you, but not you. Everybody. With different distances. Some of them very near to you, for example, your family members. Some are not near to, for example, your peer group and your social members, and some of other people in other parts of the world. All our environment, all our environment. With different distance, that sometimes we call it this distance as intimacy. Intimacy is the emotional distance between you and other people. How emotionally can trust somebody? If you can trust emotionally to other people, to a specific man or woman, he or she is your intimate partnership. Because of that, the emotional distance, trustable emotional distance is one of the first and very simple definition of what is intimacy. I am intimate with someone in the psychological approach. I am intimate with someone that can I can say their recent secrets, not the, for example, secrets of 5 years ago or 10 years ago, their recent secrets, I can tell him or her, he is my intimate partner. You should, you're your wife, your husband, sometimes your friend, and many people are alone without no intimate relationship. They have wife, they have husband, they have mother, they have friend, but nobody is intimate at this situation that they can say their recent problems, secret to them. And passing through each stage necessitates a resolution of a crisis or conflict. It is versus. For example, I said the first stage is about versus, trust versus mistrust. These are the eight parts, the eight stages of psychosocial development of Erik Erikson. The first part is trust versus mistrust, birth two, and autonomy versus shame and doubt. Initiative versus guilt, industry versus inferiority. And yes, you can find it here. Identity versus role confusion. It is very important at the age of adolescence. You can see here, identity versus role confusion. Intimacy versus isolation in early childhood. And you are now at this conflict, intimacy versus isolation. Between age of 20 and 13, people are at this stage. Can we have a good intimate relationship with others or no? It is better to be isolated. It is early adulthood, between 20 and 30. And after that, at the age of me is generativity versus stagnation. It is middle adulthood, between 35 to, for example, 65. And at the end part, it is ego integrity versus despair. It is near the death. When you are at the age that you think that I don't have enough time in the future for starting any new things, you think that, can I integrate my different parts of life together or not? it is ego integrity or no, I cannot integrate it. As expert people have a good ego integrity. They have a conceptual framework to look at the world. Other developmental theory, it is cognitive development by Piaget. Jean Piaget, as Switzerland, a scientist from Switzerland, says about he was a biologist, PhD of biology. At the age of 23, he was a genius. And after gaining the PhD of psychology, PhD of biology, he thought we can find the same rules of physical protection, physical existence, in the mental existence, mental protection, mental health. One of the concepts that he entered and he borrowed from biology and entered to the psychology was the concept of adjustment or adaptation. He says that equilibrium that have the balance between different elements of our mind is equilibrium that will give us a sense of survival in our mind. For example, if you are anger, if you have some aggression, if you feel major depression, if you feel a stress or anxiety, if you feel fear or sadness or melancholia, or no, the other wise, if you feel serenity, the sense of calmness in your inner world, or sense of happiness, or sense of courage on yourself, for example, zest, have a vitality and other parts, positive or negative. It's not important about the positivity or negativity. It is about the senses and emotion yourself. Piaget said that our mind wants to create a balance between different components of itself. To be at the best stable, equilibrium is mean stable, homeostasis. At the best stable, at the best balanced situation of mind. Because of the different aspects and different elements of mind come together and work as a whole, which is called your mind, which is called your thought. Because of this, Piaget said, talk about cognitive development. He died in 1980 when I was 10 years, 9 years. I saw an interview with Piaget in YouTube that the interviewers asked him, why have you considered your life, whole life, to cognitive development? His answer very honest and genuine. I love it. He said that at first, because I love this area. It is not about the importance of the matter that I consider for example, cognitive development. I like to understand how cognition shape in our mind, in which time, in which age we understand that something is deep or not. For example, perception of depth, which is one of the greatest cognition perception, cognition development. For example, before age of 4, if you change the depth of something and ask the children at the age of 3 or 4, they cannot answer. For example, sexual consistency. Until the age of 4, children doesn't know that their mother will be always a female and their father will be always a male. Until the age of 4, they don't have any perception of sexuality consistency. They think, yes, after, for example, 10 years, their mother can be their father until the age of 4. Between the age of 4 and 8, they have this cognition, this mind, this thinking. They start to thinking that, yes, my mother will be always my mother as a female, and my father will be always my father as a male. Between the age of, it is called sexual consistency or sexual perception. These are the components, very interesting components of cognition, of thinking, that Piaget researched about it. Also, one of the critics about Piaget is that his samples was only 2 people his children. His children were the only children that he could work with them. But in work with them, he could discover many, many, many facts about the developmental psychology or cognitive development, the process by which a child understanding of the world changes the function of age and experience, intellectual development. We have four stages in the theory of Piaget, so-called cognitive development. By Piaget, we have four stages. After Piaget, the followers of the other scientists added one sequence, one stage again to the fourth, and it became the five stages. But basically, Piaget development of cognitive development stages are four stages. One, sensory motor stages between the age of, from birth to the age of two. After sensory motor stage is the pre-operational stage between age of two to seven. After that, it is concrete operational stage between the age of 7 to 12. And after that, it is formal operational stage after age of 12 to adulthood. But what is sensory motor stage? Piaget says that in the first 2 years of our life as a child, as an infant, infant is for 2 years. The first 2 years of your age is called infancy. For example, if you want to go to airplane and have a ticket, they said, what is the age of your children? If you say it is, for example, 1 year, they said, yes, he or she is infant. So newborn, the first 4 weeks of your life is called newborn, only 4 weeks, only 28 days. The first 2 years of human being is called, in psychology, is called infant. Not in psychology, in science, in medicine, in psychology, in business, it is called infant. When we call somebody infant, it means that he or she is at the maximum rate 2 years. Under 2 years, it is infant. Between 2 to 12 is called childhood. Between 12 to 20 or 22, it is called adolescence. Between 20 to 55, to 65, it is called middle age. Adulthood. Adulthood has three parts. It is young adulthood, middle age, and old adulthood. After 65, it is called old age. Also, there's an additional part for 80, after 85 years old, that I have forgotten the title for after 85. But there's, in some books, they said it's a special part of your life, after 85. But after 65 years old is called old age. In sensory motor stage, how do you think in the first 2 years? You think your cognition is at the stage of sensory motor. Sensory is about your five senses. Motor is about your movement. In Latin word, motor is meant movement. For example, we say motor inherited or genetic motor memory. Inherited or genetic motor memory is called the memory you have about your movement, that you know, but you haven't learned it before. You know it when you are in the world, you enter in the world by your genetic, by your inheritance. And understanding comes from touching, sucking, chewing, manipulating objects, starting 9 months, develop after that. Object permanence. What is the object permanence that develop after the age of 9? The awareness that objects and people continue to exist if they are out of sight. For example, I show it to a 1 year child and see, yes, it's the mouse of my computer. When he or she is 4 years old, I will hide it at my back and say, what is at my back? He says, your mouse. When at the age of, for example, 4. When he is 1 or before 2, only sensory motor, only he or she can think about something that in the area of 5 senses. If it is height, he or she think that it doesn't exist. So not to see is mean not to be before the age of 2. Not to hear, it is not to be. Not to touch, not to be. Not to smell, not to be. Sensory motor. What exists in the area of sensation? What you as a child before the age of 2 can see, can hear, can taste, can smell, and can touch. major five physical senses. It says that it is called object permanence. Object permanence is mean that the object exists is not related to our sensation. If I see it or I cannot see it, it exists. It is permanent, object permanence. But before age of two, I think that if I cannot see something, it doesn't exist. Because of that, it is called object permanence. And pre-operational stage between age of 2 to 7, develop in the language between the age of 2 to 7, it creates our language. Why? We can find the words as a symbol for the outside of our mind. For example, I see this is mouse. And after 5 minutes, I ask, for example, from the age of 6, what is mouse? He says, that things that it was in your hand and you can use it for example, working with your computer, it was mouse. He or she cannot see the mouse at that time, but he can remember the name of that tool as mouse, mouse of computer. It is called pre-operational stage. In pre-operational stage, you cannot calculate, you don't have any operation, but you can think with the words. Words are the auditory symbols of the word. Words of the auditory, it's a voice. I say mouse, mouse, it's a voice. In my country, it says mush, mush. What is the name of this in Korean language, Amy? You are muted.
Mm?
What is the name of this mouse in Korean language? Mouse of computer?
Mouse.
Mouse, okay. For example, it's a joke. For example, you think in one language they say, for example, kala kala, kala kala, for example. In that language, it is called kala kala. In my language and Haimi language, it is called mouse. It is a voice, kala kala, mouse. It's a voice. Indeed, this voice is a symbol, is a representation in my mind. What are we talking about? It's a representation, mental representation from the as a voice. It is called words. It is called speaking. It is called language. Between the age of 2 to 7, people start to work with their language and use of symbols, still use egocentric. Egocentric thought, it's mean that we use the word entirely from his or her own perspective. Between the age of 2 to 7, many children, also I remember that age, that I thought that, is it really my father or mother? Perhaps I have come from another. I just remember this thought about the age of 6 before going to school. I remember that one night I thought that I have come from another world, another, for example, planet to this world, and he or she is not my real mother. And they are all here to protect me for a great permission, for a great mission in the future. In that age, it is true. It is normal, it is natural, it is true in that age. After that age, it is called magical thinking. It is not true. For example, if I am 50 years old, now I think, yes, I have come here and all around me have come to protect me for a specific mission. I have grandiosity personality disorder. I have egocentric. It is not true, it is not healthy. I have some mental disorders, personality disorders. But between the age of 2 to 7, it is correct, it is true. It is the nature of that time of development. In concrete operational stage, We are starting to think logically. We are starting to think logically, but only at the level of that we can see. For example, there's a proverb in my language that says, if you have great floor in the winter, you will have more snow because your floor is great. It's hard for you. But it is the real and observable meaning. It is not the hidden meaning. The hidden meaning is if you have some great chances, you have some great problems. It is the hidden meaning of that proverb. If you want to have to be more successful, you should expect more problems. Lots of egocentric thinking, logical thought develops, but difficulty understanding abstract. Abstract is perceptual. Abstract is something not observable. It is subjective, not objective. Abstract, symbolic. Hypothetical questions, beginning marked by understanding of conversation. Amount, value, volume, or length of an object doesn't change. When it's shape change, for example, amount of liquid in short, fat glass, amount in tall, skinny glass. They start to think during the age of 2 to 7 to 12. And based on Freud theory of psychosexual development, this time of development is the best time of older age. It is the calmest age. Before 7 and after 12, you are chaotic. This time is better, the best time for education. You don't have any problem with yourself. Not sexual problem after 12, not childhood problem before 7. Based on psychosexual development theory by Freud, Sigmund Freud, the founder of psychoanalysis and psychodynamic. Based on that theory, it is very important to know about this time of knowing about development. And the final stage of Piaget is called formal operational stage, 12 to adulthood, abstract, formal, logical thought, like Haimi, like Matthew, like me. We can think abstract, we can think formal in the specific shapes, and logical thought, 1, 2, 3, 4 stages in an operational, because that it is formal operational stage, okay? These two theories of development are very important in psychology, okay? So start to go to your exam and do it for 15 minutes if you can do it or you cannot do it after the class. It's better just do it now. Any question?
No question.
Matthew, any question? Have a good night.
No, Professor. Take care.
You too. Bye.
Professor.
What, Amy?
I already finished my quiz.
Okay. Have you do it before?
I did, yes.
Okay, perfect. Have a good night.
Bye. Have a nice evening. Have a nice weekend.
You too.